Welcome to episode 9 of VR Roundtable. I am one of the hosts, Anthony, and I am coming from the Republic of California. We have built a wall around the state of California now. But anyway, coming live from California, and we have Gary coming from the UK. And we, of course, have Steve coming from the East Coast, Tennessee, Steve, or where exactly are you anyway?
Kentucky.
Louisville, Kentucky. It's very different than the host state.
Okay. Louisville, Kentucky. Yeah. All right. And so here we are, episode 9 of VR Roundtable. And we have a number of news stories to get into. And we also have some what you've been playing, which is going to be kind of interesting this week because both me and Steve got our hands on the PlayStation 4 Pro. And we've been able to try that with a few VR games. So we'll be able to talk about that a little bit later. And so we got some good stuff to talk about this week. So, Gary, why don't you go ahead and start it off? What is the biggest news story that we have so far this week?
Oh, well, yeah, we have got a big news story this week. The fact, I think it took everybody by surprise, and it was a bit of a shock when it was announced a couple of days ago. Yesterday, it might have been yesterday morning for me over here in the UK, but it's the announcement that there is going to be a wireless add-on for the HTC Vive. Now, it's made by a company called TPcast, and there's not a great deal in the way of specs at the moment. There's a bit of confusion and a little bit of skepticism as well surrounding this, but it's certainly an interesting announcement and one that has got a lot of people excited. Now, it's an add-on that you can buy, and it's going to be released. It's already gone up for pre-order. It's already sold out yesterday morning, and it's for $220 US dollars. And it's got various things about it. Now, I've tried to source as much information that I can about this little add-on. It's a little bit difficult because there's so many people sort of contradicting each other when they talk about this. But from what we hear, it's got about 1.5 hour battery life for the unit, which will power the HTC Vive. So you just have this little clip that attaches onto the top of the headset. Then you have a small battery that comes with it, which sits on the back of your head. And some people have mentioned that this might act as some kind of counterweight to the front of the Vive. So it might be beneficial for that as well. So you've got about 1.5 hours battery time with this battery that gets included with it. But you've also got the option of possibly getting a larger battery that will sit on your belt with a cable going up to the headset. So this is all been announced, but we don't know the prices or anything like this for these extra batteries. Now, the website, when they announced this, the TPcast and the guys at HTC who were interviewed, this was sort of a article that was on Upload VR. They were saying that there's no noticeable difference in terms of latency. And this got a lot of people, sort of probably 50% excited and another 50% very skeptical about this statement because they don't really know how this could be possible at this time. But it's that they're looking at a 60 gigahertz signal. And that gives a transfer speed of around 3.5 gigabytes per second, which is fast enough to run the Vive headset at 90 frames per second and the resolution that it needs to be. So this is using some kind of custom technology, some kind of custom hardware that is obviously been developed by TPcast in order to get this level of quality. Now, what they're saying is with this 60 gigahertz signal, a lot of people, because I don't know a great deal about the Wi-Fi technology or anything like that in this, but from what I've read online these past few days, people are saying that for this 60 gigahertz signal, you need some kind of line of sight to the transmitter that goes to the PC. So it's even your own body could potentially block the signal from getting through. So people have been pointing out things like occlusion and things like that could possibly hinder this from working effectively. But overall, I mean, my own impressions of this it's very exciting news. Now, I went onto the website when these things went up for pre-order, and I was getting it, wasn't operating particularly well, and it was sort of, I was getting messages up saying it was sold out. Then I was getting messages that I could go through to the checkout, and then it sort of stopped. So I think there was a lot of demand, but apparently these things sold out within 18 minutes of the pre-order going live. And so I couldn't get hold of one. And I mean, I was in two minds anyway. I went onto the website at the time that they were going up for pre-order. I didn't know whether I would jump in on this at the moment, because the sensible thing, and a lot of people have mentioned this, the sensible thing is probably to wait and see what happens with this, get some kind of reviews, get some hands-on, some kind of like a digital foundry, or maybe the guys that tested, just to give this a go, just to see if it really operates the way they say it possibly can. Now, so I didn't know whether to go into it or not, but I went on the website just to see if I could get a pre-order, if I wanted one. And it turns out I couldn't anyway, so that made my mind up. But yeah, that's really like the technical background that I managed to source from this. I'm sure you guys have seen this as well, but yeah, what are your thoughts?
Just me personally, I'll say that, when did this announcement come out? Was this on Thursday when it first hit?
Yeah, I think it was Thursday morning, actually. Yeah.
And I think it, for us, I think it was kind of later in the afternoon Thursday, because I'm pretty sure, well, I don't know. I think I might have been on Reddit earlier in the day and I never saw anything about this. And then I got home from work and I was dealing with some stuff in regards to trying to get my PS4 Pro. And I happened to just bounce over to Reddit real quick, or I might've been on like NeoGAF or something. And I saw this announcement about wireless HTC Vive of, you know, it's available, bam, 220, you know, bing, bing, bing. And I saw this headline. I'm like, oh my God, what the hell is going on here? But I was kind of like, didn't know whether I should be thrilled or depressed, you know, because it's like, this is hella, I mean, this is a really cool thing, of course, for anybody that has a HTC Vive, but I've dropped so much money recently on all this other PSVR crap. And it's like, oh my God, now I got to pay $220 for this thing, or do I want to buy it right away? And like Gary was saying, you kind of wonder, when people get this, is it really going to work right? Is there going to be some little side effects? You know, if you've got a battery that's right at the back of your head, I imagine that thing probably gets pretty hot after a while. So you kind of have a built-in heater, I guess you could say. But I don't know. I'm kind of just of the mind that I'm going to just let everybody else get these things in. And if everybody is raving about it over and over again, and, you know, people have had them for months and they've played with it for months, then I'm sure I'll probably have to jump on the bandwagon as well. Because I mean, I've said it a million times that how awesome would it be if you were playing Vanishing Realms and you could just walk around in your play space without having to worry about that cord that's kind of pulling on you a little bit. But I mean, there's good and bad things too, because I was thinking about this the other day. I was like, well, you know, if you truly were wireless like that, I imagine that you're going to be straying out of your boundary a lot more often than you normally would, because I've mentioned this before as well. I kind of broke a controller when I was playing Brookhaven, and it was because I was doing this Brookhaven style where I was using the knife and I was like just slicing zombies' heads off and like getting really visceral about it and like swinging my arm super fast and stuff. And I ended up like on the complete other side of my room and I smacked onto a metal thing that's over by here. And I can imagine if you had a wireless headset, that would be a lot more likely, you know, because you're just kind of walking around. So you're going to walk into your chaperone boundaries a lot more. But at the same time, I mean, how many times have you been playing Space Pirate Trainer or whatever it was, and you kind of get tangled in your cord and you got to move your leg, and just not having to worry about that would be incredible. So I'm kind of cautiously optimistic, I guess. What about you, Steve? What's your take?
Like you guys, it kind of came out of nowhere. I wasn't expecting it, and then when I saw it on Reddit, I was, oh wow, it wasn't rumored or anything. It was just like boom, there's this thing and it's up for pre-order. I'm excited that there's evolution already. You know, we're under a year into to the Vive, and I think it speaks good that HTC, and I'm assuming I'm not incorrect, but HTC is the one selling it, even though this other company, TP Mark or whatever their name was, is manufacturing it. Am I correct there?
TP Cast, I think they're called.
Yeah, but this is actually, but wasn't it being sold by HTC? So I mean,
yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So that's my point, is that means that HTC has vetted this. You know, they're putting their name behind it, and that tells me that the technology probably should largely work. I'm a little concerned about the specific comment, no noticeable difference. To me, in engineering speak, that means there is a difference. So, you know, we'd have to see how that plays out. And one thing I was looking, and I only saw the one picture of it, and it looks like they did a pretty good job the way they attached it to the existing straps. But I was looking for a DC power adapter, or a way that, let's say you were playing and your battery died and you were deep in a deeper experience instead of a shorter arcadey type experience. You know, if they let you plug in a DC power adapter, you know, you'd have a wall wart plugged into your wall and maybe like a 30-foot cable, and it'd be just a thin DC cable. And so that would help elevate, for me, concerns of running out of battery and the whole battery issue. And even though you would get tethered, you would only be tethered by this very, very tiny cable. And it could possibly operate and maybe even charge at the same time. So I didn't notice any kind of little power supply input or anything like that. I was looking for it. The other thought is, you know, maybe they would give you the USB and audio and HDMI port in the bottom, so that if you ever had to kind of go back and forth, you weren't in a state of trying to take this add-on off and plug your tethered cables in the original way. So I'm hoping there's a workaround there where you're not reworking these straps that much. But other than that, you know, I'm going to follow it. I don't know if I'd take a gamble. And in my personal, my play space is 4 meters by a little shy of 3 meters. So I could feel the cable, of course, but I never felt really, really, really constrained by it. I'd love to ditch it, but you know, the value, I think, is going to be a little different for different people. You got a real big play space, you're going to want this a little more. So I'm keeping my eye on it. I'm pretty excited.
Yeah, I'm interested in it too. But you do make the point where you think maybe $220 for this kind of thing, it might be a little bit too expensive for really, I mean, the inconvenience of a cable is an inconvenience, but is it really $220 worth of an inconvenience? That's the thing. But you both make a couple of good points there, actually. I mean, in terms of the charging of the device, I didn't think about what you mentioned, Steve, there about where you could just add in like a long DC cable that could be attached to the headset, because 1.5 hours is, a lot of people have mentioned, you know, it's quite a long time in VR, so it might not be a problem. And maybe you could do some kind of hot switching with the battery. Maybe, I don't know if they've incorporated that type of technology. So if you buy two batteries, you can just swap them over while you're using the Vive. But having something like that as an option would be great. So yeah, that's something. And also what you were saying, Anthony, is something else I didn't really think about, you know, having this freedom, because I've got a small play space, really a relatively small play space to a lot of people, and having that extra freedom where you've got the cable on the back of your head, and it does sort of keep you in check to a certain extent. And maybe without that, you will be going to the more extremities of the play space and maybe hitting your controllers and things like that. So there are a couple of things I didn't think about. And with the latency, a lot of people are saying, you know, they've got this statistic on the website, how it's sort of less than 1 millisecond latency, which won't really affect anything. But a lot of people are saying how that's not really what they're talking about with that. It's a different type of latency that you're going to experience within the headset. And they're saying that that's around 15 milliseconds, which could sort of put it really at the very limits of what is acceptable within VR. So it's a little bit close to call. So I think I'm sort of grateful that I didn't get a chance to pre-order one of these things, because I possibly would have gone ahead with it if I did. And I think as I said earlier, I think the sensible thing to do is to just wait for some reviews, see how it fares in these reviews and take it from there, because it's not something that I really think is that urgent for me. As I say, that the cable's an inconvenience, but it's not something that is really that damaging to my VR experience, really.
You know, one other thing to mention too, I've heard a few people wonder if there could be potential health risks with having a battery and then also the gigahertz or whatever it's running at and the wireless signal and having the battery like so close to your actual skull and all that type of thing. The idea that you would have that you could get a battery that would be at your belt, I think that's actually a better idea, because I think if you had the battery like on your belt somewhere and then you have a wire that runs up to it, you could have extra batteries, and then it would be easy enough where when you're blinded by the headset, you know you have this right here in your belt and you just snap it off, you snap another one on and bada boom, bada bing. But, you know, the hour and a half, I don't know about you guys, but if I'm in VR for more than 45 minutes to maybe an hour, it's hard to stay in VR for like hours and hours. The longest I've ever been in VR in one shot is probably like an hour and 15 minutes. And when I came out of there, I was like, you know, kind of exhausted and stuff. Cause I mean, you know, it just wears on you a little bit. So I think maybe 1.5 hour is okay. Now, maybe when I get Fallout 4, I'll think differently. You know, Fallout 4 VR, maybe I want to play for 2 full hours or something. But I think if you had the battery pack on your hip, that actually might be better for swapping. And when Steve mentioned having a really thin cord, I actually think that could be a little bit more dangerous, because the fact that the Vive cord is as thick as it is actually a plus, because if that was super thin and you really could kind of forget about it, then you could get into a situation where you get that thing all wrapped around your neck or whatever, and you don't even know it until like the last possible second, and you trip and you're like, ugh, you know, and you're freaking choking on it. So it's going to be interesting to see all these little extra questions that you don't normally think about. And that's why I'm kind of willing to let all these other gung-ho Vive people out there, let them kind of beta test this thing and see. Because if this was super easy, why wouldn't Oculus be doing this right away? Why wouldn't Sony be doing this right away? So it's definitely not super easy. But if this really does work out, and it really works good, this is a huge advantage for HTC going forward. Cause I would imagine the Vive 2, they could, I mean, if it really works that good, they'll probably just integrate it into the Vive 2.
Yeah, probably. I would hope that's a natural progression. And you know, you're talking about the batteries on the back of your skull. Let's just hope that they're not manufactured by Samsung.
I was just thinking the same thing. So. But yeah, and just one thing to mention about this as well, they were sort of hinting this company TPcast, they were sort of hinting of the fact that it's really not necessarily just exclusive to the HTC Vive, because it's pretty straightforward connections that it could possibly be used for the Oculus Rift as well. They've just not formally announced anything for them. So a lot of people are saying it could probably be applied to that as well, really.
Yeah, with the Vive, it's going to be transmitting the, you know, because the Vive is transmitting its tracking data via the USB back to the PC. So with Oculus, it should be, in theory, less bandwidth.
Yeah, you know? Yeah, it's a good point. Yeah, yeah. But yeah, it's definitely exciting, and I'm really glad, because I wasn't expecting anything like this for at least like late next year or something like that. But we're hearing rumors of, well, not rumors, but we're hearing reports that there are companies working on this wireless technology. But it was a big shock to see this on Reddit last week. It just pop up saying HTC Vive wireless add-on. And
it's also... Yeah, it's good. Last week we were talking about Oasis, a Vive kind of 1.5, or not really a 2.0. it's good that this is an add-on and that everybody that is interested can buy it, and that it's not, oh, here's Vive 2.0 with wireless baked in, you know, $7.99 pre-order. So I thought that was a good direction too.
Yeah, Kobe Bryant tried it. I wish they had a little video that had an interview with him, like, actually saying, yeah, man, I had the headset on. It worked great. I didn't notice anything. You know, I kind of want to see an interview with somebody that's actually used it. You know, I've seen some of the videos and it looks like it's working okay.
Yeah, yeah. It's, I think, like we've said all the way through this, I think that the best thing is to just wait and see when it's released and people have got it in their hands and can do some kind of reports and give us some real details on this. It's that's really when we're going to be able to judge on if this is the real thing or not. And, you know, there was something as well, because I think HTC are working with a company called Quark to develop some kind of wireless solution as well. So this has come from a completely different company, but it's being sold on the HTC website. So it just makes you wonder how they're getting all these different companies to do the same solution for them. It seems like they've got fingers in a lot of pies, really.
I think this TPC Cast or whatever it is part of, they had like this $100 million thing where, you know, like, we're going to invest in all these different little things, you know, and we're going to maybe give this company $3 million, give this company $1 million, this company $500,000, and they're going to put all this money around into all these other little projects and then see if anything turns into some fruition for them. And it appears that this is like one of them that kind of paid off. But yeah, there's a lot of companies that are working on all kinds of wireless stuff. I know, I think Valve was working with somebody, weren't they? Recently, I heard, not too long ago. Was that the Quark thing, maybe?
It might be that one, yeah. Yeah, maybe that's who I'm thinking of. Yeah, I know that there's a lot of companies that are trying to find some kind of solution for this. So if this turns out to be the real deal, then it'll be very good. And I think, to be honest, that price, although it, as Steve says, it'll vary in mileage for different people of their different setups, because not everybody's bothered by the cable. I think it'll be, I don't think that's a ridiculous price to charge at this stage for that kind of technology as well. So people that are interested can jump on board with it. I suppose, as I said before, I may have pre-ordered one, but that's a pre-order that I could have cancelled at a later date. I'm under no obligation. So that's something as well to take into account. And I don't know if I would have really gone through with this pre-order at that price. But having said that, it's certainly technology that interests me.
Yeah, you know, speaking of like wireless technology and wireless VR, one other little news story that hit, I don't know if you guys saw this at all, but there's a company, I don't know if the company is called Zero Latency, but their arcade concept is called Zero Latency, and they have this in Australia. I believe it's Melbourne, Australia. They have basically, it's like a big warehouse that you're inside of, and they're using some special type of tracking technology that can track a wide area. They have like tracking sensors all over. And then you have a group of people that are all walking around inside this large warehouse area, and they have wireless HMDs, they have backpack PCs, and they have what look like shotguns almost that are like tracked. And it's like a gigantic multiplayer game where everybody's inside the game at the same time. And so like the real humans that are walking around, those are like the good guys. And then I guess all the enemies and stuff are the bad guys that you're shooting and stuff. So it's kind of like cooperative type thing. I don't know a ton about this. I remember there's a lady that works for IGN, Amanda Pierce, I think. I might be getting that wrong. That might be somebody else, but she's Australian. She was talking about this on one of their podcasts saying that, oh yeah, we have this Zero Latency in Australia and it's like backpack PCs and you can walk all over. And so this is going to be coming to Orlando, Florida. They're going to be making a Zero Latency outlet basically in Orlando, Florida. So kind of like the Void, what they have going on in Utah. It's interesting how there's a lot of these concepts springing up. And this is something I talked about back a while back when I was thinking, you know, vanishing realms. I mean, just imagine if you were in some gigantic room and you could just freely walk. I mean, it would be just incredible to just freely walk anywhere, because it's going to be a long time until we have some type of floor surface that we can get that scrolls in any direction and is super smooth, and you can take off running, and, you know, like a treadmill, like a treadmill that goes in any direction. You can take off running, you can cut, you can stop, you know, do all that type of thing. It's going to be a long time before we have something like that that's affordable for people in their own houses. But from a warehouse concept, I'm really interested in this, because I don't know if you guys have ever played like laser tag or something, like your kids have a birthday party and you go to these laser tag places, and it's a pretty cool concept, but the idea of being able to play laser tag, but you're like in a, you know, like you're in like this Halo environment and it looks incredible with, you know, incredible graphics, and you're touching the walls and stuff, and there's real walls there, you know, there's real pillars there. There might be some seats you can sit down and the physicality of it and everything. Did you guys see anything about this zero latency arcade?
Yeah, I saw it was on Upload VR, I think. Road to VR, one of those websites where I saw it, and it looks interesting. As a business model, I would be very curious as to how much they are charging. What they've done from what I could tell, they have the backpack, like you mentioned, and the HMD, and I forget which brand. It's not a Vive or an Oculus. It's one of the other brands, maybe the Stars brand. They then have on the shotgun, on the gun that you're carrying, it has two glowing orbs. It almost looks like PS Move controllers. And then I'm pretty sure there were extra tracking sensors that the people wore on their body. So the article I read did mention a proprietary tracking system. And I don't know if that was picked up the HMD as well, but it at least is picking up the gun and the other motion tracking devices. It looks like in video game development, when you see an actor or an actress doing motion capture, that's essentially, and I imagine the technology is very similar. So in this warehouse, you know, people were playing a zombie-ish game. It was a game that I'd never seen before, so I'm guessing this is also a game that is proprietary to this company, and the only way to play it. And I'm not sure you could go there and play, like you say, Vanishing Realms or something like that. Maybe you could. So yeah, it looked like laser tag VR. It looked like it would be stripped down to a very specific experience. But I agree, the dream of just being able to roam around in 10,000 square foot warehouse and never run into a chaperone or any type of boundary would be awesome. If I lived closer to there, I would go and try it out for sure. But Orlando's a far away from me.
Yeah, I'd love to have a go at this kind of thing. Just talking laser tag, my son had a birthday party today, actually, and we went to a laser tag place, and I went in there, and because this news was sort of fresh in my mind, I was thinking, how could they do it? Because, I mean, I suppose within the that they have all these sets set up, so everything within the warehouse corresponds to something within the virtual world. So it's not just an empty warehouse. I think they've got sort of blocks and things like that set up as well. But apparently, I looked into this a little bit with this news that came out, and they use the OSVR headset, the HDK2, which was... I don't know. I know it went up for pre-order a couple of months ago, maybe, but I don't know if it's actually been released or if it's available now. But it's it's sort of a basic VR headset. I think it's more or less on the specs of the Oculus and the Vive, maybe slightly lower. I'm not too sure on that. And like you say, it's got this custom tracking rig set up, and like you say, Steve, it looks almost exactly the same as the PlayStation. Set up with these orbs, these glowing orbs on the guns. And I mean, I'm sure it works well for what they're doing. I mean, if they're prepared to do this and sort of sell these experiences within this VR, then I'd love to. I mean, when we get something like this over here in the UK, I mean, it probably won't be set up near where I am. So I'd have to go to somewhere like London or somewhere like that to really try this. But it's exciting if they do set this up. And something in the article, it said that this is the US's first warehouse VR experience. But I thought the Void had been going for a while. Is that not sort of warehouse scale, or is that a different thing? I don't know.
The Void, the way I understand that is they have like a 30 by 30 room. And I think it's, I think the idea behind the Void is it's not so much that they put like 50 people in there and they're all in the same thing at the same time. I think it's more like three or four people at a time, and they kind of go, it's almost like being on a ride, you know? And so it's like three or four people get to do the Ghostbuster thing, and they go through the room and they do, and then, you know, you got to wait, and then another group of three or four people get to go through there. So with zero latency, you're talking about maybe 50, 60 people all walking around at the same time that are all in the experience.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Speaking of this though, there was one other little story that popped up. I don't know if you guys saw this, where IMAX is working with the Star VR guys, you know, the Star VR headset with that super wide headset. And it was just a quick little blurb, but I heard something about how IMAX is looking into this, because IMAX, I guess they're going to have at some of their IMAX theaters, they're going to start building in some little VR experiences that people can kind of go into, where they kind of, you know, companies like this, they have to think about the future. And VR is the kind of thing that IMAX, I mean, why do people go to IMAX? People go to IMAX to see a gigantic screen, you know, that takes up their entire field of view, and you have to turn over here to see the whole edges of the screen. And VR is a threat, really, if you think about it long term. We can get the IMAX experience in our headsets almost. I mean, they can almost recreate that. I mean, we don't have the resolution to do it, but companies like this, they're going to have to think 10 years from now, how are we going to get people to keep coming to this place? And so they're looking at the Star VR thing. So it is exciting to see all these different little arcade type things that are popping up, because, you know, arcades basically died, and, you know, arcades don't really exist anymore. But maybe with VR and the idea of having this higher end VR experience, we kind of will have arcades return in some kind of way, even if it's just like a laser tag replacement type thing.
Yeah, I mean, with this IMAX thing, I guess it's really the fact that resolution is the big thing that's holding back the headsets to replicate that experience. And I think from what I read on that, just very briefly with this Star VR, they are going for quite a high resolution headset and really sort of giving it the best possible experience that they can for people that go into that. And they've invested something like $50 million. And just one other thing that I saw this week, which was, it was announced at the same time, well, on the same day at least, as the wireless add-on for the HTC Vive, is the fact that MSI got these pre-orders for their backpacks, their PC backpacks for virtual reality. So I don't know if you guys saw this, but it was there was actually a post on Reddit which sort of said how it was a bit poorly timed, really, unfortunate timing.
Yeah, it's got to be a nightmare. I mean, a huge nightmare for the announcement of something like that.
Yeah, I bet the executives at MSI were doing some meme-worthy expressions when they saw that.
Yeah, just quickly as well, because it's gone up for, I mean, the thing is, it might not be obsolete, but the way that this wireless add-on technology is progressing, eventually these things are going to be obsolete. And I guess the manufacturers of these are really rushing them out as fast as they can to capitalize on virtual reality that needs to be connected to a PC, because they're selling this PC, this VR backpack for $2,000. And they're going to start shipping them on the 30th of November, the lower end models at least. And they've got a pretty good spec of PC in them. It's like a 1060 or a 1070 and i7 CPU. And they're not particularly heavy as well. So I think they're a good unit. It's just that the problem is, when they've been announced alongside this wireless add-on, it really doesn't bode well for them. And as I say, even if this particular add-on that we've heard from this week doesn't turn out to be anything, does have problems with latency, then the the backpack could still have a place for maybe a couple of months, but who knows? I mean, at this rate, the thing that's exciting at the moment with VR is just how fast the technology is progressing. It's incredible. And you every day you go on the internet and you see something new that's coming out or some rumors or something like this. So it's very exciting time to be into VR.
The VR as a whole has a lot of hurdles to overcome. And, you know, I think with like flat monitor gaming, we've kind of tapped it. There's nothing else to really overcome. TVs are huge and cheap and the technology maxes it out. So there's a lot to overcome, but the backpacks have an advantage. And when we get more information next month from the Microsoft steered products, anything with inside out tracking still would have a benefit with a backpack type solution. Cause then you just grab your HMD, you grab your backpack and you go set up in your garage or somewhere else. And there's no tear down and setup. It's just kind of ready to rock and roll. So I still think that's something to keep an eye on. Largely, I think the bigger market, at least for the next few years, will be, you know, people using Vives and Oculuses and set up in a specific room where they've mounted tracking devices.
Well, you know, what do you call it? IMAX and zero latency, they need to have some kind of backpack solution. So I guess MSI could sell to them if they can't sell to the consumers. But other than that.
Yeah. So that's pretty much all the news that I saw this week. I don't know if you guys got anything that you want to add onto that.
Just one last blurb. You know, the slim HTC cord that everybody was so, everybody wanted to get the slim HTC cord. Apparently, if you order the cord now, you're actually getting the slim, where before it was kind of like a dice roll. And it was really only the people that had to do a RMA got the slim cable. But I did see more people saying that they've ordered a replacement 3-in-1 cable and they got the new one now. So that might be a thing as well.
Oh, that's
of course, cool. Nobody really cares now if everybody's going wireless.
yeah, I see all these.
There's gonna be a flood of new 3-in-1 cables on eBay.
See how it turns out. Anyway, but anyway, let's turn it over to you two guys who've got the PlayStation 4 Pro and see what your impressions are, especially with PlayStation VR.
Steve, you want to start it off?
I'll let you go first.
Okay. So I just got my Pro on Thursday night, actually, and I got a good deal on it. I got to talk about this for a second. I don't know if anybody knew, but there was this Target wishlist app. I talked about it, I think, back when Target was doing the buy two, get one free deal where you get like a little 10% off thing. Well, people discovered that this actually worked with the PS4 Pro as well. So I went to Target on Thursday night, because I actually ordered it from Target.com and I got an email that was like, you're back ordered. I wasn't going to get it until like sometime next week. And so I was like, well, let me check and see if my local Target has it. And so I called my local Target and they're like, yeah, we have two of them. And so I raced down there and I have the Target Red Card, which is basically, it's just a debit card that's, it's like a debit card basically that's linked to your checking account, but you get an extra 5% off. And so if you're going to buy stuff at Target anyway, might as well, you know, what's 5%, might as well do it. But you could also stack this wishlist app, which was another 10%. So I actually got my PS4 Pro for like $372 out the door. You know, so it wasn't that huge of a price difference for my upgrade. So that worked out really nice. And then, so I get the thing home and set it all up. I don't have a ton of games to try. One of the things that's a little bit unfortunate is like the demo disc does not show any of the pro stuff. So you have to have a full version of the game to see a difference. And the first game I tried it with was Battlezone. And right away, boom, I knew immediately, like when the thing first starts up and it does like the little logo for Rebellion, the company that makes the game, and just the menus and everything. I could just tell that everything was just a little bit sharper, a little bit cleaner. And then when you actually get into the game, basically what I noticed is that in your cockpit, you know, you're in the tank, and in your cockpit, you have these different panels that are kind of around you. And then you have these huge windows of glass, and you can kind of look out of them and you see the cannons on the side of your tank. You know, when you arm the different cannons, zzz, you know, a cannon will come down over here, or a cannon on the left side. And when you look at all that stuff, anything that's connected to your actual tank that you're in, everything is just sharper, a little bit more well-defined, a little bit cleaner, a little bit crisper. But when it comes to the backgrounds, like the background scenery where your tank is moving around, and like the background buildings and stuff, and like kind of mountains and stuff that you're moving around inside of, I really didn't notice any difference with that. And I kind of was, that was something where I was hoping there might be a difference there, because I kind of feel like the colors are a little bit muted in Battlezone. Like sometimes you'll see a screenshot of Battlezone and it looks incredibly colorful and neon and like super bright. And I think some of those screenshots are almost like touched up a little bit. They're not quite as accurate. When you get into the real game, it depends on the levels. You know, some levels look a little better than others, but the colors can be a little muted, and sometimes you don't clearly see a differentiation between like one little area and another because they kind of blend into each other a little bit. But the tank that you're in and everything in the tank, I mean, there's a definite difference. And then also the things that are moving around in the environment, like the enemy tanks, the enemy airborne enemies that you're fighting, anything that's moving, that also seems to be a little sharper, a little bit more well-defined. And the best way for me to explain the difference is like, if you've been using composite video for a long time, you know, like the red, white, and yellow plugs, you know, the yellow plug is your composite video from like way back in the days. If you were using those type of plugs and then all of a sudden you upgraded to S video and it would just be a little bit cleaner, a little bit more well-defined, not as much ghosting, that's kind of the difference that I saw with Battlezone. But it's there. You see the difference. And so when I played that, it was a huge relief for me because honestly, we were going to have a show earlier this week. We thought we might have a show when the PS4 embargo, the PS4 Pro embargo came to an end, and you would have like Giant Bomb and Tested and The Verge and all these places might have a report on the PS4 Pro. There wasn't that many of those. They did have some, but they weren't focused on PSVR. They were talking about 4K, HDR, and all that stuff. They barely mentioned PSVR. There might be a tiny little blurb about it, but some of the ones that were out there had some, you know, they kind of said the difference is incredibly minimal. I wouldn't pay this money for it. So all that stuff kind of had me a little bit concerned. But when I got into Battlezone, I mean, it's clear if you want the crispest, best version of Battlezone, then you pretty much need the Pro. So I did notice that. Another game I played, Rush of Blood, that one didn't notice a ton of differences, but I will say that there are a couple different times in Rush of Blood where you have these birds that come flying at you, and the birds can be incredibly pixelated when they take off and they're flying at you. And I noticed that on the Pro, since getting the Pro, the birds don't seem to quite have as much pixelization. And then there's also parts where you're going through Rush of Blood and there's like these ghosts that kind of appear and they're almost like translucent, and it's like ghost here, now ghost in your face, and it scares the hell out of you. And I noticed that stuff was just, it could be placebo effect too. We don't know, you know, sometimes it can be placebo effect, but it seemed like that was a little bit cleaner and a little bit sharper. And then the last one that I can comment on is Batman VR. And Batman VR, there was no specific knowledge of any kind of pro patch for Batman, but I believe when Rocksteady designed this game, they kind of designed it in a way where it kind of automatically will adjust itself to more power. And one thing they were saying, I believe this was on Road to VR, is that in the normal version of Batman, when you have your headset on, the outer edges are blurred, and the to kind of, it's like foveated rendering without the eye tracking, but just kind of the outer edges are blurred and your center vision is a little bit clear. And Batman on the Pro, they basically turn that off, so there's no blurriness. And I was playing through, I didn't save like my progress on the previous PlayStation 4. I just wiped it, and I figure, you know what, I'll just start over, and I'll just start all the games over from the beginning, because I didn't have like these really long saves where I was super far into it, so I didn't worry about it. So I started Batman over from the beginning, and there does seem to be a little bit of a more crispness, a little bit of a more detail going on, but it isn't one of those things where you give it to the average Joe Blow and he puts it on and he's like, oh my God, I notice it right away. It's more of one of the things where people that are a little more particular, people that are a little more nitpicky about every little thing, those are the people that are going to notice the differences a little more, I think, from the three games I tried. I only have three games. I had that Eve Valkyrie, but I actually sent that back to Gamefly hoping to get maybe Robinson the Journey or Eagle Flight so I could talk about those. And I didn't have a PS4 for like 5 days, so I was like, well, I might as well send one of these games back to Gamefly while I'm waiting anyway. So only tried those three games, but Steve, I know you have a few other games that you probably tried. What was your experience on the Pro?
So when I got the Pro set up, and it transferred real well. I did the Ethernet PS4 to PS4 transfer. So as an aside, that worked real well. So I got it all set up, and the first game I wanted to play was Rigs, because it's the one that I've spent the most time in prior to the Pro, and I knew that would be my best opportunity for picking out any differences. And I noticed on Reddit, for people that got the PS4 Pro the day before, some people always manage to get lucky, there had been comments that Rigs was a good improvement. So I put Rigs in, and yeah, it was pretty, of all the games that I'll talk about, it was the second most noticeable. If you played the game, you'll know, you can kind of look out the corner of your eyes or turn your head and you see your two big guns, your left gun and your right gun. They improved that there, which I thought was really interesting, because that was already one of the better looking parts of it on the base PS4. And once you actually get into a match, one of the first things that I really noticed was there were additional textures. And I don't think it was just a resolution increase that was hiding the textures. I think the developer enabled additional textures. So in the arenas that you're having your matches in, there's a lot of ramps, and things seem to be really made out of metal and things of that nature. Now things have a texture, and it was really noticeable. But there seems to be an across the board resolution increase as well. Looking at enemy mechs in the distance are a little bit clearer. All the text is clearer. The HUD seems a little clearer. And there's a lot of speculation, and I'll comment on that with a grain of salt, that the PS4 Pro must process colors a little better. And I'm not talking about high HDR or anything like that. There's been a lot of release snapshots that suggest that colors are a bit more saturated in a good way on the Pro. And that does seem to be the case. Things just seemed a little more, like you were talking about with Battlezone, Anthony, things just seemed a little more touch towards the screenshots that you often see. So Rigs was a very positive and a very good Pro patch. I also played Rush of Blood like you, and I didn't notice a substantial gain, which kind of bummed me out. I was expecting a little more, because I felt like that game was maybe running a touch under native res. One of the things that really stood out to me was the conductor / ring master guy that you know, you're with him at the start of every level. His face had a whole lot less like shimmer in, I don't know the correct term, but pixel crawl. Like, you know, when something looks like it's moving and it's not, you can use to tell it in games, trees and stuff in the background. So there's a lot less pixel shimmer on him. The little doll's face that represents the loading wheel, that was a bit more clear. So I could tell that they did up the resolution. And I think some of the look that I personally don't like is an art style thing. It has this grain to it. And that may be why I was a little underwhelmed with that patch. I think they are intentionally going for a look that I just personally don't favor. I did not play Batman, but I did read about what you mentioned, how they disabled the foveated rendering. I didn't play Eve Valkyrie because, as far as I could tell, a pro patch hasn't been released and there doesn't seem to be a pro mode. I could be wrong. One game that I did play that I recommend you play, and you can, Playroom VR has by far, without a doubt, the best patch. And it's not even a patch. This was enabled from day one. And we can talk about something that I think related is a lot of mixed messaging out here about how these patches are. And I think Sony's continued to drop the ball there. But Playroom VR did not need a patch. And immediately it was that wow moment, like, oh, okay, this is what it's about. I didn't play all the games, so from the second you launch it looks immediately better. All the menus look immediately better, and I played Robot Rescue, which is kind of the one that's a lot of people's favorite, and it was like, it was just as clear as Lucky's Tail. You know, Robot Rescue before on the base had, even though it was a great game and had a good art style, it had this noticeable blur. Compared to Lucky's Tale, I thought it was a lot blurrier. And that's setting aside the screen door differences. With the Pro patch, it felt every bit as clear as Lucky's Tale. And I was amazed by the improvement.
It looked like I did play Playroom. I forgot about that. I forgot to mention it. But I did play the Robots Rescue. And like you said, yeah, immediately it's just... It also seems like it feels better. Like, I wonder if Robots Rescue is native 120 frames, because it seems like on the Pro anyway, because it just seems better. It just feels better. And then there are certain points in Robot Rescue where you're kind of like walking through a little cave or something, and there's like all this foliage that's coming down, like leaves and stuff. And when you get really close to the leaves, they look way better than they did with just the regular PS4, and everything just felt better. You know that part in Robots Rescue where those wheels are like rolling and you got to shoot out your thing, and then you grab it and you break it up into a bunch of little pieces, and there's little bad guys you got to fight. All of that was so much cleaner and crisper. So yeah, I mean, Robots. And then also, I don't know if you tried this, Steve, but that one little game where it's, you know, it's like the UFO catcher game, you know, those machines that are in like pizza shops and stuff where you try to win like a little teddy bear or whatever that's in the balls. And they have a little thing like that in Playroom. And I tried that, and everything in that was super sharp and clear. It truly is a major difference. Whatever Japan studio, like however they programmed this game, they knew all about the Pro, and they had that crap dialed in straight up. I mean, that stuff looks real good.
Yep, and it didn't take a patch. So, and it's what I found interesting. Going back earlier this week, I was really anticipating reading reviews and getting some good data and information on how the Pro was going to be, because Sony has not given good messaging on here. And I understand why, you know, from a business and corporate messaging perspective. So I was really let down by all the big review outlets, including the VR centric ones. Road to VR made an article / review. And ironically, they had only tried Battlezone. And in this video that they put up with Battlezone, they did this side by side, you know, PS4 on one side, PS4 Pro on the other. But the video was uploaded in 720p onto YouTube. So that doesn't help anybody. And then they tried that in Batman. And Batman was not listed as, even though there were differences detected, Batman was not listed as a game that was pro-enabled. I get that that Rocksteady could have had a pro mode baked in and with the initial release, and it didn't need a pro patch to enable it. But in Sony's messaging and the list of games that they come out with that said had PS4 Pro support, I'm about 99% certain Batman wasn't one of them. So it struck me as odd that Road to VR would use those two games, not play Rigs, not play Playroom, which was free. They should have had access to it. So I think it all boils down to Sony's messaging or the developers' messaging. You know, these big outlets, they received their PS4 Pro, you know, early last week or whenever it was, and they had 4, 5, 6 days to play with it and write the reviews, and they had to do their, you know, their 4K and cater to the non-VR mainstream audience. I get that. But when they tried to talk about VR, it seems like they didn't know which games had pro support, or you know, maybe some of the pro patches weren't out during the review period. So instead of just coming out and saying that, they tried to release these reviews, I guess, to be competitive with other outlets. And they were like, they didn't put enough information out there, but yet they still passed judgment. So that kind of irked me a little bit. And one site I really trust for stuff like this is Digital Foundry /Eurogamer. And they said, hey, we haven't had time to really vet this with VR. It looks, you know, the gains are to be seen. Looks kind of minimal for now, but I'm expecting them to come out with some real information. And maybe they have in the past couple of days. I've been busy and haven't checked. So I kind of wanted to touch on that because I was real bummed the way the industry really treated the messaging around this whole thing.
Mm-hmm. Just quickly, Anthony, you made a really good comment, I think it was last week, about how Sony are probably relying a little bit more on the word of mouth going around about the PlayStation 4 Pro, because it's difficult for them, as we've all said, it's difficult for them to really have a good messaging about this. They don't want to isolate the 40 odd million PlayStation 4 users that are already out there. And this is, we rely on things like Road to VR and to produce to pass on this message, to do this word of mouth. And that video that you mentioned, Steve, about the battle zone footage, it was next to useless. There was no point in putting that on YouTube as far as I'm concerned, because I saw that and there was nothing new about that really. But I really wish that they'd, maybe it's just the amount of time that they've had with it, they've just not, that they're trying to get some videos out there just to show something, but they're really not showing anything substantial at the moment. And that's something that I'd really like to see, some really in-depth discussion about the differences, especially with VR, obviously with this being a VR centric show, about the differences of PlayStation 4 Pro. And so it's good to hear your personal experiences with all this as well. And just coming from as an outsider, because I've not had a chance to try this, it's disappointing because I've not heard anything other than what you guys have been telling me tonight about the intricate differences of what's been going on with PlayStation 4 Pro and PlayStation VR. So maybe over the next week we'll get some more information, and especially with Digital Foundry, and maybe I mention them all the time, the Tested guys as well, because I think maybe they'd try it. It'd be good to hear some more opinions on this kind of stuff.
You know, some of the outlets out there, what they were doing is, you know how you have the social screen, you know, what's on the TV? Like, not what somebody's seen in the headset, but what's on the little, they were doing comparisons of that. Mm-hmm. And like, okay, here's the social screen, probably because that's what they can capture, you know. So they capture the social screen of a regular PS4, and then they capture the social screen of PS4 Pro, and then they can put them side by side, and they can look and say, oh, there's these little tiny little differences here and there. But it's really, it's what the guy is seeing on their head, you know, with the headset on. And to really compare this the right way, you really need to have a PlayStation 4 right here. You need a Pro right here. You need to have a PSVR on both of them. You need a copy of Battlezone on both of them, and Batman and Rigs and every single game that it is. And you basically need to put the headset on and be like, okay, I'm going to be on this menu screen. I'm just going to leave it on this menu screen. Okay, here's regular PS4. Okay, give me the other headset. Here's Pro. I mean, you almost have to do that. And it's going to be very difficult for them to specifically say that, oh, this has exactly this much. You know, it's really the eye of the beholder, the guy that's wearing the headset. But I can say, I mean, you guys have worn VR headsets and you know what it's like when you're in VR and when you're surrounded by a game 360 degrees and you see the little geometry that's in the game, the little things that they have in the game, little enemies and little things that you're picking up off tables and stuff like that. When you see that stuff in VR, you get a really good feel for it after a while because it's right there, it's in your face, and you start to get a feel for it. And so then when you go to the Pro and you pick up some of those things, you could possibly notice this slight little difference between some of these objects because, let's face it, I mean, this stuff is going to be kind of blurry. It's going to be pixelated because they cannot throw incredible Gears of War 4 graphics at 90 frames per second to each eye. They have to make things a little simpler, a little bit more basic, and things will be pixelated. And so a minor improvement in pixelation might not seem like a very big deal, but if you're going to be in these games and you're going to be playing these games for like 30, 40 hours, like I'm going to spend a lot of time in Battlezone. And so the difference in Battlezone on the Pro and Battlezone on the PS4, it might not be like, it's not night and day. I mean, it really is. And I can't come on here and say, oh my God, it's incredible. It's like a completely different system. I can't say that. It's very similar. But for somebody like me, I mean, I've always kind of been a graphics whore. Like going back to the old retro games, I play like Super Nintendo and stuff. I'll play that on an RGB monitor because I want to see every little detail in like Link's shield or whatever. You know, I want to see every little freaking detail. And so somebody like me that's kind of meticulous with that stuff, I'm going to notice that stuff. But there's other people, you know, you put them in front of like a Blu-ray or a DVD, they can't tell the difference, you know. So it depends on the kind of gamer you are. And I'll say that right now, I don't think it's this night and day difference where, dude, the Pro is incredible. Oh my God. But the one thing I'll caution on is this is early days. These are the launch PS4 games. They've been making these games a long time ago, probably before the Pro was a twinkle in Sony's eye or before they really knew about it. Now, Japan's studio being within Sony and being in Japan as well, they probably knew about it earlier, and that's probably why Playroom VR might look like the best game of the ones that we've seen. But when we get to Farpoint, because Sony specifically mentioned Farpoint at that PlayStation meeting, so when we get Farpoint, I think we're going to see what the Pro is capable of, you know, and I think those enemies are going to be sharper and more detailed. And I think when they were building Farpoint from the very beginning, they might have had like, okay, you five programmers over here, all you guys are going to do is take the base code and rework it with the Pro and get as much juice out of the Pro as you can. So I think when we get to spring 2017, summer 2017, fall 2017, I think that's when we're going to really see a bit more of an improvement with Pro. And that's where it's going to be more of like, okay, now you probably do need a Pro. But for people like me and Steve, you know, we're already loving this stuff as it is, and we've already bought into the concept. And so for us, it's like, if we're going to enjoy this stuff, what's a couple $100 among friends, you know? I mean, we might as well upgrade, get the Pro, and see things just a little bit sharper, you know? So that's kind of my final take on that, basically.
I agree with you. For me, I have zero regrets picking up a Pro, and I think the rewards are going to be incrementally better as we get further along in this PSVR landscape. You had mentioned, and I don't want to touch on it too long, but for anyone listening to this that is contemplating the whether or not they want to get a PS4 Pro. The social screen, it is processed by this processing unit that we've talked about, and it's down res pretty massively, and it does not represent what we see in the headset. Not because, you know, flat monitors don't represent what we see in the headset, but also from a resolution, it is running at a resolution that is inferior to the resolution inside the headset. This processing unit, it dewarps the image that is intentionally warped because of the lenses. And there are times I take my PSVR off and I look at, and I'm in the Sony XMB, like this, that's what's behind me. And in PSVR mode, it looks like total crap when I look at it, the social screen out aspect. So anybody that's going to do a capture PS4, PS4 Pro comparison using the social screen, immediately disregard it. I'm hoping Digital Foundry will actually have like one of those Elgato capture cards that they put in line. And I don't know if this can even be done, but if it can, they put it in line and grab the raw stream going to the HMD itself. And it'll be kind of warped on the sides, but at least in the center, they can do all of their deep pixel counting and can better convey the benefits of the PS4 Pro, at least from a scientific or a data-driven aspect, and try to limit what is going to inherently be subjective takes on it and people's opinions.
Yeah, I think I was going to ask a question actually to both of you about how, if you think the PlayStation 4 Pro is worth buying at the moment with taking PlayStation VR into account. I think you've both pretty much answered that. But looking forward, personally, I think you will get more benefits with the Pro in the next 6 months when, you know, because like you say, it's just so early days at the moment. And there's going to be more patches coming out, and it's going to be not only that, the games are going to be more focused towards, maybe because you've got the Pro, developers want to give us the best possible game they can give us. And if it means giving us a better version for the Pro, they'll do that, because they've not really got any concerns about Sony's problems with the PlayStation 4 and the PlayStation 4 Pro. They want to give everybody who owns that an option. And I think we will start to see some benefits with VR at the Pro, because, I mean, from my understanding, it's a machine that's roughly sort of twice as powerful as the PlayStation 4. So if they can get a clearer and crisper image on the Pro, I think they'll give us that option. It doesn't really matter the fact that it might make people on the standard PlayStation 4 feel like they need to buy a Pro, because they've still got the game, and the Pro is, it's just an extra slight resolution increase maybe with super sampling. So I think it's all going to play out in the end, and I'm sure we will be getting better quality visuals on the Pro, but that's not necessarily to say that the PlayStation 4, the standard edition, which is what I own, if I was to get a PlayStation VR, that's the system I'm going to play on. I'm not going to purchase a Pro. I'm happy with what I've got on the PlayStation 4, and eventually when I do get a PSVR, that's the system I'm going to play it on. So I fall into the camp that should probably be a little bit annoyed, but I don't think it's a big problem. If they can give us an extra benefit, then why shouldn't they?
Yeah, one thing I kind of wish that Sony would do actually is the demos don't show off what the Pro is doing. And I think it'd be kind of cool if like they released like some new demos that actually do show off what the Pro is doing. Because basically the only way you'll know if one game or another really has any kind of Pro thing going on is you got to get the full game to actually see it. And so I only have the full game for, you know, Batman and Russia Blood, Battlezone, and then Playroom VR. So those were the only four I could try. I would have loved to have seen Drive Club, although I've heard that the differences aren't that great, but stuff like Thumper, Res Infinite, I heard that, you know, the Area X, which is the area like the very end of the game where it's like almost a totally redone game, I heard that has a big bonus. There's a game called Bound that some people are saying looks incredible on the Pro. But then, you know, you get into the PSVR subreddit and there's a lot of opinions that get thrown around and you're not really sure how big of a deal it really is.
Yeah, I forgot to mention, I have Thumper and I tried it on the Pro and it was, that was a game where it looked good before. You know, it's a very simple art style and it doesn't appear to be too taxing, even on the base PS4. So it was hard for me to discern a difference with the PS4 Pro. I think the little beetle that's running down the racetrack, it looked a little less jaggy, and some of the background stuff probably a little less jaggy, but it was probably of all the games I tried the most unnoticeable.
And some of it, we're not going to even notice anything, but when we're done playing, we might have less eye fatigue. That's another thing too. And maybe Sony could be a little more upfront about, well, this game was running at 60 frames and then we reprojected it to 120, or now this game is running natively at 90 frames and it's being reprojected to 120, you know? And so maybe that's why it feels a little bit better. I don't know the technical mumbo jumbo of how all that works, but what I do know is that after, like, I was playing Playroom VR and it seemed the robot's rescue, and when I was done it was like I didn't have as much eye fatigue. I for some reason I feel like it's running smoother, you know. And so there's some games that might be doing that too. One other thing I want to mention real quick is that I didn't have my PS4 for like 4 or 5 days while I was waiting for the Pro to come out. And I went back to the HTC Vive. Remember that thing? And I started playing some Vive games again. And when I first put the Vive on, I was having some fogging issues. So it's kind of a weather thing, you know, because I hadn't used the Vive since it's gotten a little bit colder, you know. And so, because I remember when I was first talking about PlayStation VR, I was like, there's a lot of fogging issues, but I think it's just the weather thing, because I had a little bit of that with the Vive too. The other thing I noticed immediately was, wow, the circle grooves, you know, the glare is so, it's very noticeable. It really is. But on the plus side of the Vive, you put that thing on your head and it's locked in. You know, you got a good view. That shit is locked in. You put the PSVR in your head and you're like, oh, it's a little bit blurry. Wiggle it this way. Wiggle it this way. There's a little bit of a irritant with PSVR from the standpoint of like always kind of wiggling it around to try to get it dialed in. And with the one nice thing about the Vive, I mean, it's not as comfortable, but you get that thing on your head. You don't have to wiggle it around. You're dialed in. That's one good thing. The game that I played Windlands, you know, because everybody's talking about Windlands on PSVR. So I was like, let me go back to Windlands. I was playing that again. I know we're running long, Gary. I saw you look at the clock. But I just want to talk about Windlands real quick, because I finally got to a new level in Windlands. And I was on this one area where you're basically doing platform jumps like a Mario game, but you're freaking like 10,000 feet up in the air. You know, and there's these little square blocks that are like kind of floating in the air, and you have to kind of like run and jump from one block to another, and then kind of like slow yourself down and then back up and then run and try to jump to the next block. And my fear of heights, remember how I was talking about my fear of heights, seems to have returned. I don't know what the hell's going on, because I thought I was finally beyond the fear of heights thing, but I was jumping from these platforms and I'm like, you know, this is feeling kind of weird. So I played Windlands a little bit. That was really fun. And then I played Island 359, because they did an update. Did you guys hear about this update? It was like a Triceratops or something. There was some update for Island 359. I went into that real quick and I saw a Triceratops, but I was actually dealing with a bunch of compies that were attacking me. And then I finally dealt with those guys, and then the Triceratops must have walked off somewhere and I couldn't find it anymore. But I played that a little bit. But the takeaway that I have is, like, room scale is still incredibly powerful. Being able to just walk around in a large play area is incredibly powerful. And so, you know, I still love my Vive. I know we've been kind of PSVR focused in these last couple of weeks, and I'm still in this PSVR love honeymoon phase, but getting back to the Vive for like 4 or 5 days, it was a pretty cool experience.
Did you find that, how did the screen door impact you? Because for me, that's what bothers me the most when I put my Vive on now.
Yeah, I mean, the screen door is there. I see screen door when I'm using PSVR as well. It's just not as pronounced. But if you go into that demo disc, if you go into Wayward Sky, Wayward Sky reminds me of Lucky's Tale from the standpoint of how they use the color and just how there's just something about that game engine where it's just so clean and so clear that in a game like that, you can really see the screen door because everything is so clean and clear that you can see the screen door. And it's the same thing with Lucky's Tale. If you want to see exactly what the screen door looks like, put on Lucky's Tale, because there's something about the color and the engine and whatever that you see the screen door. And I still see some screen door on PSVR, but it is reduced. But for me, it was more of the circular, the glare. The glare thing is really an issue. But I mean, once you get into the game and you're playing the game, you don't really notice it as much. So
yeah, that the glare thing on the lenses is the most annoying thing for me with the HTC Vive. And when I tried the PlayStation VR, that was something that I'd noticed straight away. But for me, I mean, I've been playing just quickly as well. What I've been playing this past week, it's mainly been Elite Dangerous, really. I've got back into it and I really do enjoy this game. It's something that with a HOTAS stick, a joystick and throttle, and you can really immerse yourself within this world. And it's one of the more, it's got a lot of, I mean, I hesitate to say depth because it's quite a basic game really, but there's a lot of little attributes to it that really make it more of an experience really when you're playing it. And the other day, I mean, you were talking, Anthony, about the length of time earlier, the length of time you spend in VR, and I'm exactly the same really. It's quite short experiences that I do. It's things like maybe I'll go in and play VR for 30 minutes to an hour, and then I'll have a break. And then if I get time, maybe I'll go in for another half an hour or something like that. With Elite Dangerous, the other night I was playing it for 2 hours straight, and it felt like, and I'm not joking, it felt like half an hour. I couldn't believe I'd been in there for 2 hours. It's such a immersive game, and it's hard to believe that this wasn't built for VR, because it's something that I think they had VR in mind when they were making this game, but it's a game that works so well in VR, and people have spoke about it. It's been out for a long time and they keep updating it, keep reiterating on certain aspects of it, and I encourage anybody to really give this game a try, just even the arena part of the game, because it's only it's £5 here in the UK, and you can just go in and it's more like a multiplayer Eve Valkyrie type experience, that is, but that doesn't interest me as much. It's the full game, the full immersion of being in this world, traveling between planets, between playstations, sorry, not playstations, space stations. But yeah, it's really, really immersive game, and I could easily, I mean, this is one of the few VR experiences that I could just spend hours in there and not even realize it with. The other thing, I mean, I'll just quickly run through a few other things that I've been playing this past week. The Trackmania Turbo demo, which is a racing game. It's very there's a lot of stunts and things, and people were worried about it being a nauseous experience in VR, and they've toned it down. It's pretty good. The demo is worth downloading. I definitely recommend that. It's not something I'll be buying. And the other thing is probably Marlene as well. It's just a free demo at the moment as well, which is a game that's coming out soon. And that's like a horror type experience. I've not got too much to say, but I just thought I'd mention it here for anybody who wants to try that. But yeah, I mean, Steve, have you got anything else that you want to mention that you've been playing this past week?
No, I had a busy week. I haven't played anything else other than what I mentioned earlier. I did not know Trackmania came to the Vive, so it also came to the PSVR, so and it has a demo. So that'll be one of those unique opportunities to kind of just kind of try it in both and you know, more talking points. So I'm going to try to give both a whirl.
I tried the PSVR version, actually, the demo for that, and I thought it was freaking cool. I thought it was super awesome. I thought the graphics looked really good. It's weird how it's a driving game, but it's almost like you're almost like got this overhead perspective and your car's down there and it's in front of you and the car is going. I definitely need to download. There's a demo for the Vive, Gary?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I tried the demo for the VR. Thing is, it's quite a short demo because, I mean, if you tried it on the PlayStation VR, I'm sure it's the same one, but the tracks are very, very short on VR. So it doesn't take very long to play through. And I don't know, Anthony, how did you feel like, because it's an external camera on the car, but it does zoom in on certain parts as it does in the normal game of Trackmania, where you're going through the loops and things like that. And I didn't really like that. I'd rather it either stayed in an external mode or you had the option to sort of have a cockpit mode or something like that.
Yeah, that, well, on the PSVR, they actually give you like, there's an arcade mode and another mode. And there's like two tracks that I think are open on both of them. So basically there's like four different tracks that you can try, but it is incredibly short. It's like a little tiny section that you get to try, but I thought it was really cool, actually. I don't know how much the game costs or like any of the other details about the game, but the graphics to me on PSVR, I was surprised. I mean, it looks way better than Drive Club in terms of like the graphics. And I have to try the Vive version so I can kind of compare them head to head, but I was surprised by that one. Oh, Steve, did you ever get to try the Harmonix music thing? Did you ever try that? Or you didn't like it?
No. I tried it, and I forgot to talk about it. And it was pretty cool. I didn't care so much for the where you manipulate the little figures and can make them dance. But towards the end and the initial, because the demo walks you through four little like short experiences back to back. And the end one where you're just in an acid trip from the 70s, I guess, it's music is playing, there's a song, and I kind of like the music, even though I'm not familiar with it. But then it's like a psychedelic. Remember those little toys that you would put your eye in and spin them, and they had all sorts of crystals and different colors? It was like living in one of them, and you're just colors and shapes are going by. And I thought that was really really fun, and I think I'm gonna let my kids play it because they like that kind of thing. So yep, it was worth trying out, and thanks for reminding me.
Yeah, it's pretty. I mean, you can get your own music on like a little USB stick, and then put it onto the PS4. But you have to have the full version. But it'll do like a music visualizer, so you can kind of just kick back, enjoy your music, but see all kinds of crazy stuff, and you don't even need to take any drugs or anything because it will take you on a trip all by yourself, and it's pretty cool. I don't know that it's worth $15, but I thought this is not as bad as I thought. You know, I mean, people don't talk about that thing very much, and I thought it was kind of cool. So,
yeah, Harmonix is a good developer. You know, they've done real well with the Rock Band and stuff, so I think they could do well here.
All righty, so is that pretty much going to wrap it up for us, or does anybody got anything else they want to get in real quick?
No, I don't think so. I think that's everything I had down.
Oh, I forgot. We mentioned it before, but Arizona Sunshine for the Vive got a release date. I believe it's December 6th, December 8th, 9th, something that first week and a half of December. It's priced at $40. It's a little steep. I actually played the demo of it. It's hard for me to remember. 3 months ago. It's been a long time. So there was a demo circulating out there, and you know, you can give it a try if you can find it. It was polished. It's going to be a good game. I I don't know if it's going to be a $40 worth game, but it was good. It was a lot like Serious Sam in terms of the quality of polish and how good it felt. And it was zombies. So I keep an eye on that. And then I think we also got confirmation that Abduction from the spiritual successor to Myst that I know everybody played. And it's officially coming to, it's already out on the Oculus, but it's coming to the Vive, and I almost want to say they announced that it's going to come to the PSVR as well. So I've talked in the past about, you know, the big thing for me in both of these VR platforms is high kind of bigger dollar software, and this is the type of thing, you know, kind of want to, for me, is kind of my pet peeve and my driving factor. So having two big games that we know are coming up relatively soon is good.
December 6th is the day the Touch comes out. And I think that Arizona Sunshine, they had to wait for that date because I think it's available on Oculus the same day.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
And, you know, Dead and Buried is going to be a free game for people that get Touch. Did you guys hear about that? That's one of the Oculus games a lot of people talk about when it comes to Touch.
Yeah, I saw that as well. Yeah, that looks really cool. I think that's excellent that it's coming for free as well.
The guy that curious does... how they release that. If they do some sort of verification, you have a Touch. The developer for Revive, he has said that he will have Touch cross compatibility in Revive. So if they throw that up like Lucky's Tell, we're all going to get a crack at it.
Yeah, it's almost like they should give like require people with the Oculus Touch to have like a serial number that they plop in and then they get a code or something. Cause honestly, I mean, I have no problem paying money for Lucky's Tale. I feel like I still feel like I owe Oculus for Lucky's Tale, but yeah, if I can download Dead and Buried and I can try it with Revive, I'm going to try it. I mean, why not?
Yeah. It's, I know what you mean. Lucky's Tale is a great game. It's absolutely fantastic. They've done really well with that. And Dead and Buried, it's one that people have been talking about for quite a long time. And it's just good that it's being released just to promote the Oculus and the Touch. It's a really good idea. One thing I just want to mention quickly as well, if anybody wants to contact us via email now, I've set up a VR Roundtable email. So if you just email us at vrroundtable@gmail.com and then just send us any questions or any comments about the show, that'd be great. But other than that, I think, we're pretty much wrapped up this week.
All righty. Well, that's going to do it then for episode 9 of VR Roundtable. And like always, if you guys could possibly leave a comment on the YouTube page, if you can leave a review for us on the podcasting service of your choice, that really helps us out as well. And then again, if you want to send us a question or something, go ahead and send us a question to vrroundtable@gmail.com. Is that it?
That's right. Yep.
That's it. Okay. Yeah. And go ahead, send us a question and we could possibly use it on a future show or maybe a topic or something like that as well. So that'll do it for us on episode 9 of VR Roundtable. And we'll see you guys next week. This is Anthony signing off.
This is Gary. Thanks for watching, everybody, and listening. If you're on the audio podcast, I'll see you next time.
And this is Steve. Good night.
Later.